Warning: this experiment uses highly corrosive sulfuric acid and chlorinated solvents. Wear gloves when handling them. This experiment also generates sulfur dioxide. Work outside or in a fume hood. Greetings, fellow nerds! In a previous video, I made chlorotoluene by reacting toluene and a chlorine source like chlorine gas or trichloroisocyanuric acid. While this worked very well and gave better than 80% yield, the resulting chlorotoluene consisted of a mixture of para- and ortho-isomers. Since different experiments require different isomers, we'll need a way to separate them. Now, ortho- and para-chlorotoluene have slightly different boiling points, and so they can be separated industrially by fractional distillation. Unfortunately, the overlap of their vapors is so great that you need a huge column of 200 theoretical plates or more. One of the patents I read called for a column 13 meters long. Yeah, my puny little V-grow column is not going to cut it. We're going to have to use a chemical approach rather than physical. So here is our mixture of chlorotoluene isomers, about 450 grams worth. Now, chlorotoluene is clear, but my sample is cloudy due to tiny amounts of water. This is not a problem though. Now, add about 65 milliliters of concentrated sulfuric acid. This corresponds to a 1/3 molar equivalent. My acid is red because it's low-grade drain cleaner acid. High-quality acid will work better, but isn't strictly necessary. Now, set up a Dean Stark apparatus around the flask operating in heavy return mode. I have shown how to make these in a previous video. A traditional apparatus cannot be used because it only returns the lighter fraction, but we want to return the heavy fraction. Now, chlorotoluene boils at around 160 Celsius. To minimize heat loss and make this reaction go faster, I'm insulating the hot portions of the Dean Stark apparatus with foil. Normally I'd insulate more of this, but I'm leaving some parts open so you can see the progress of the reaction. Now, turn on the heating to 300 degrees Celsius and let boil. What we're doing is sulfuring the chlorotoluene and releasing water. By turning up the heat high enough to boil the mixture, the water boils out along with chlorotoluene. The Dean Stark trap allows us to conveniently separate and return the chlorotoluene and just keep the water. By removing the water from the reaction, we drive it forward. Now, an interesting thing happens with the isomers of chlorotoluene. Ortho-chlorotoluene reacts faster and is more stable than para-chlorotoluene. This is because the sulfonate group is quite bulky and thus is more stable on positions far away from any other substituent. On ortho-chlorotoluene, this is easy since there are two positions it can react with that aren't beside another substituent. But on para-chlorotoluene, wherever it goes, it will bump against another substituent. So para-chlorotoluene sulfonation is less favored than ortho-chlorotoluene. This effect of physical crowding affecting reactivity is called the steric effect and allows us to fine-tune a lot of chemical reactions that way. In this case, we're using it to resolve ortho- and para-chlorotoluene. Now, even though some of the para-chlorotoluene is reacting, this isn't a problem because the reaction is reversible. So the sulfuric acid regenerated can go to react with the ortho-isomer. If we use equal or less sulfuric acid than the ortho-isomer, we can get almost exclusive ortho-sulfonation. Unfortunately, this is rather slow. So keep the reaction running until the water content in the Dean Stark trap stops increasing, and then run an extra hour to ensure an equilibrium is reached. Now you're probably wondering, if I know this mixture is 60% ortho-chlorotoluenes, which I want to remove, why did I only add 1/3 equivalent of sulfuric acid, which is not enough to remove at all? Well, I did try adding a stoichiometric equivalent, but I then noticed a large amount of decomposition happening. The chlorotoluene sulfonic acid decomposed at high temperatures and concentrations to chlorocrystals and sulfur dioxide. By limiting the sulfuric acid to less than 1/3, we limit the concentration of chlorotoluene sulfonic acids and thus limit the decomposition. The drawback is that we'll have to repeat the process to convert more of the ortho-chlorotoluene. Okay, looks like we're done. Now turn off the heating and let it cool. So here we are. Now, while some of our chlorotoluenes is in the Dean Stark trap, most of it is here as a mixture of chlorotoluenes, chlorotoluene sulfonic acid, and decomposition products. Now, if you look very closely, there's a small amount of separation of the components, but there is still a lot of contamination, and it's very difficult to get clean recovery of just the chlorotoluenes this way. So we're going to use steam distillation. To the mixture, add an equal amount of water. Since I have about 500 milliliters total, I'm going to add another 500 milliliters of water. Stir it up until thoroughly mixed. Now assemble the Dean Stark apparatus around it and set it up for light return mode. You'll also notice that rather than a graduated cylinder for our trap, we're using a much larger 500 milliliter flask. This is because we're going to collect all our chlorotoluenes here. Now simply heat up the mixture until boiling and start collecting the heavier components. What we're doing is taking advantage of the fact that water and chlorotoluenes form a low boiling azeotrope. This carries our chlorotoluenes out of the mixture and separates them from our chlorotoluene sulfonates and decomposition products. This is also much cleaner than trying to decant the mixture from earlier. The Dean Stark apparatus lets us remove the water and return to the mixture to continuously carry out the chlorotoluenes. Now you might be wondering, if we originally made the chlorotoluene sulfonate by sulfonation and removing water, wouldn't adding the water back and hydrolyze it and thus reverse the process completely destroying our progress? You're absolutely right, and this would happen at higher temperatures. But since we add so much water, the mixture is boiling and thus maintaining a lower temperature at about the boiling point of water. At this lower temperature, we can take advantage of azeotropic distillation without worrying about the reverse reaction. This is also why we didn't directly distill the mixture. As said before, chlorotoluenes boil at around 160 Celsius, which is high enough to begin decomposing the chlorotoluene sulfonates. Okay, looks like the level of chlorotoluene is no longer increasing. We can turn off the heating and let it cool. Here is our chlorotoluenes, and I've decanted most of the water. This mixture is enriched in para-chlorotoluene isomers and depleted in ortho-chlorotoluenes. The residue back here contains our ortho-chlorotoluene sulfonate and some water. Now we can convert this into pure ortho-chlorotoluene, but first I'm going to set aside and focus on further purifying the para-chlorotoluene. Now this mixture has an unknown ratio of para and ortho-chlorotoluenes. We know it's been para-chlorotoluene enriched, we just don't know if it's pure. We could use nucleomatic resin spectroscopy, but if you had access to that, you wouldn't be trying to make para-chlorotoluene in your basement, and would just buy it directly from a chemical supply company. Fortunately, there is a simple test we can perform. Ortho-chlorotoluene has a much lower freezing point than para-chlorotoluene, so we can roughly figure out our purity based on that. This is because para-chlorotoluene has a melting point of 7 Celsius, while ortho-chlorotoluene has a melting point of minus 35 Celsius. Take a small sample of your chlorotoluene mixture and put it in the freezer. If it doesn't freeze at all, then it has too much ortho-chlorotoluene. If it freezes, then make a mixture of ice water and place the sample vial in that. If it melts again, then it's richer in para-chlorotoluene, but not quite pure enough. If it stays frozen, then it's highly pure para-chlorotoluene. Now, we didn't simply drop our sample into ice water because chlorotoluenes have a strong tendency to supercool. So starting from a liquid state and lowering the temperature to find the freezing point is terribly inaccurate. It's much more accurate to start from a solid state and warm upward to find the melting point. Anyway, in our first run back here, the melting point should have remained liquid even in the freezer. So we still have a lot of ortho-chlorotoluene that we need to separate. So we'll need to do our sulfonation again. Make a note of how much chlorotoluene you have now and calculate how much sulfuric acid you'll need to equal 1/3 molar equivalent. I have about 300 milliliters of chlorotoluenes and this corresponds to about 40 milliliters of sulfuric acid. There is still some water in my chlorotoluenes from earlier, but I'm not bothering to remove it since we'll be running the Dean Stark trap in heavy return mode and removing the water anyway. Now run the sulfonation as before and then perform the azeotropic separation. Then run the freezing and melting point test to see how pure the chlorotoluenes are. Keep saving the ortho-chlorotoluene sulfonates if the freezing and melting point tests show the chlorotoluenes to be impure. If however the test shows the chlorotoluenes to be pure para-chlorotoluene, do not save the ortho-chlorotoluene sulfonates from that run. This is because that particular run was when the sulfonation reaction finally exhausted all the ortho-chlorotoluene and is now consuming para-chlorotoluene. The sulfonates from that run now contain a mixture of chlorotoluene sulfonates rather than pure ortho-chlorotoluene sulfonate. Anyway, here is the purified para-chlorotoluene. It took a lot of work, and from 450 milliliters of mixed chlorotoluenes, we only recovered about 70 milliliters of para-chlorotoluenes. Most of the loss was from the fact the para-chlorotoluene was only present in about 40%, and the rest of the loss was from handling losses, since this is such a complicated and laborious process. Nonetheless, by amateur means, we have produced essentially pure para-chlorotoluene isomer. To be absolutely sure, I sent off a sample for NMR analysis. As you can see, the clean spectrum shows we have indeed produced pure para-chlorotoluene. Now for storage, I recommend adding some molecular sieves to remove the cloudiness that comes from suspended water droplets. As for the ortho-chlorotoluene sulfonates, we can now convert back to ortho-chlorotoluene. The process is actually quite simple. Just gradually heat the mixture and distill off the water and ortho-chlorotoluene. The water from the original separation of the chlorotoluene should still be in there, so we don't have to add more. What's happening is that at first the excess water boils off at lower temperatures. As the temperature rises, the water remaining reacts with the ortho-chlorotoluene sulfonates to produce sulfuric acid and ortho-chlorotoluene. The ortho-chlorotoluene boils off and distills over. Unfortunately, there's also a large amount of decomposition at these temperatures to chlorocrystals and sulfur dioxide, so our yield is severely defected. Try and maintain a temperature of about 175 to 180 degrees Celsius in the mixture to reduce decomposition. Now, if you don't actually need ortho-chlorotoluene for anything, then I say don't bother and just dispose of the sulfonates. This hydrolysis is prone to boiling over and ruining a reaction. Even worse is that once the hot sulfonates get stuck in your condenser, they solidify and it takes hours of cleaning to get them out again. Anyway, after many aggravating hours of work, I finally got some ortho-chlorotoluene. I was actually expecting a lot more than this, but a lot of the ortho-chlorotoluene sulfonates decomposed and thus reduced our yield. I think the fact that I used drain cleaner grade sulfuric acid with whatever impurities that are in it may have accelerated decomposition. Oh well. NMR analysis shows I have reasonably pure ortho-chlorotoluene, so at least this wasn't a total loss. Anyway, that is how you use steric effects and sulfonation to separate ortho- and para-chlorotoluene isomers. This is another step in our synthesis to the antiprotozoal drug pyrimethamine. Thanks for watching! If you would like to support the continued production of science videos like this one, please support the channel on Patreon. Links are in the video description.